Okay, thanks to the organizer, and it's my great pleasure to speak here. And is it clear, the words? Okay, so what I'm going to talk about today is called contact non-squeezability, and it's a joint work in progress with Dimitri Tamarkin. And okay, so let's start. So do you know there's a non-squeezing theorem in slideshow that the size of font is relevant of for the audience to receive information that is non-squeezable. Like if we squeeze the font a little bit smaller, then it will cause someone sit back far away, which couldn't recognize it well. So in order to maintain the talk quality as a physical quantity, then here is a non-squeezing theorem. And there's also a squeezing theorem, like if I shrink the font small enough so that no one can recognize this well, then we can squeeze everything, because no matter how small I squeeze, in that case, no one will care. That's what I'm talking about on the slideshow. Yeah. So you should remember this as a lemma like that. I will use this later. And okay. So this is a very fascinating celebrated theorem by Gromov, simplistic non-squeezability. Say we have a ball, open ball of radius r in simplified Euclidean space R2n, even dimensional, then the theorem said that you cannot squeeze a large ball into a ball of smaller size by simplistic embedding. Here the simplistic, just using the usual canonical simplistic form on R2n. Okay, so one might wonder that, what should an analog in contact topology look like, because contact topology is considered to be a sibling of simplistic space. So is there an analog like this? So the first thing that comes into everyone's mind is odd dimensional Euclidean space. And it's a contact manifold with a very standard contact form, alpha equal to PGQ plus PZ, and Z stands for the last R coordinate, okay? But unfortunately, in this case, we can dilate our coordinate a little bit by any positive scalar, and this will become a contact homomorphism. So, because contact homomorphism only cares about contact structure, which is a kernel of our contact form, so it's up to a scalar, a positive scalar. So in this case, any domain can be squeezed into arbitrarily small neighborhood. So there's no size. Size doesn't matter here. And due to this factor, so three authors, Eliasberg, Kim, and Poltirovich, suggest that we should consider another space. Instead of R2n plus 1, we should consider R2n times a one-dimensional space that's a circle, and it's called a pre-quantization space of R2n. Okay. But so the things change a little bit. If we change the last coordinate R by circle S1, but there's a little bit deficiency. Because even in this case, a single contact embedding is not enough to detect the size of our open domain. Here's an example. Think about R2n to be a complex plane, complex space Cn, and due to some conformal characteristic of contact structures, we can construct a map like something like this, that with a rotation on these complex parts by S1, and with a little bit dilation, which depends on the point. It's not a uniform scalar shrinking. But in this case, phi k is a contact morphism. And it could take a large ball into smaller size. And So there's no rigidity here. You can even make VK smoothly isotopic to the inclusion of the contact ball into the whole space. So a good alternative of definition is contact isotopy, that we require our isotopy to be contact homomorphism in any case. So here is their definition. So say we have two open domains in the contact manifold V, and we say U1 can be squeezed into another, this is U2. If there exists a compact supported compact contact isotopy wall, Vs such that V0 equal to the identity map, and V1 squeeze U1 into U2. And compactly supported means that outside the compact state, all Vs becomes identity. Okay, and so it avoids some situation like rotation. So you cannot make a whole space rotate. So if we stick to this new definition of a squeezability, contact squeezability, then here is their result. So there's a squeezing theorem that, just like the slide showed, that if the size of a ball is small enough, small to some numbers, then there is no constraint, there's no obstruction for you to squeeze a big one into a small one. And there's also a non-squeezing theorem that if there's an integer gap between our size, pi r squared, pi little r squared, and pi big r squared, then the big one cannot be squeezed into the small one. So yeah, so this is just the same as slideshow squeezing and non-squeezing theorem. I will say so, but they don't think so. They think this is some analog in quantum physics, like in the pre-quantization space of open balls, then it's in some sub-quantum level, the size can be neglected. And above this level, then we have something like symplectic non-squeezing theorem, because some people consider symplectic non-squeezing theorem is a semi-classical version of uncertainty principle in quantum mechanics, but we won't go there today. Okay, so and their method is quite hard to understand. It uses some orderability or something that come up with the universal cover of the group of contact morphisms satisfying some special properties. So, but in 2009, another Shenden applies method of generative function after Vitable and simplistic homology after Trainer, and she constructs some contact homology theory to give a new proof of these two theorems, slideshow theorem. And however, in their papers, the case, if there's no integer gap, it remains open. So, and actually, this is a very intuitive or a very good method that it just proves things up to a z, up to an integer. But if we can think in a more carefully way in the shift theory, then we can just throw in local generating functions to construct some shift, and using microlocal shift theory in the style of Kashiwara Shapira to prove the remaining case. Actually, we can prove that for one less than pi r squared, less than pi big r squared, it wouldn't be squeezable. Okay, so this is the basic setting. Say a ground field k of finite cohomology dimension, and why the manifold dy be a category of shift over k. So in order to apply homological algebra, we need some boundedness, bounded above, bounded below, but here we should consider unbounded sheaves. But this is not a very unbounded thing. Actually, the sheaf we are talking about today is all locally bounded. That's locally and locally open set, they are all bounded set. They are all bounded complex. Okay. So in this Kashiwara-Shapira story, we have actually a complex set of sheaves. In a direct category of Y, then we can define a notion called microlocal singular supports, which is a conically closed as co-isotropic subset in a cotangent space. And it allows us to encode Hamiltonian simple holomorphisms into sheaves. It's called sheaf quantization. And how to do this is that it's because that a Hamiltonian simple holomorphism gives you a Lagrangian, exact Lagrangian in some big space, product space. And it's a good idea to use those kind of SS to approximate the Lagrangian set, some manifold generated by those simple holomorphisms. And in some good case, like constructible sheaf or something else, we have not only co-isotropic, we have Lagrangian in the cotangents. But due to this, actually I should say homogeneous, it's not only homogeneous property of SS, so we should conify our story because not all Lagrangian is a conic Lagrangian. But it's good because in our contact topology case, contact topology can be regarded as a version of homogeneous or conic simplic geometry. Okay, so this is basic setting of homogenize everything, adding the extra variable T called RT. Okay, so but we not only homogenize this, we want to quantify this. So quantify means we only use positive scalar instead of OR. So in this case, I would like to say, let's consider about a full subcategory of DX such that the SS, the microsingular support, lies in the non-positive part of the extra variable, of the cotangent of extra variable. And then we quotient out this category. We quotient out DX by these four subcategories, and we obtain another triangulated category called D plus X. And this is our major playing field of things. Okay? So now I'm going to describe a category of objects supporting on or outside our simplified ball. So BR is our simplified ball of certain size R. And because BR lives in T star E, there is no conic structure. So let's just consider a projection from the conics with the extra variable to the original space, cotangent space. And we consider a full subcategory of this, that is objects supported outside the ball, which means that O sheaf such as SSF outside the cone of generated by BR. And it turns out that this is not only a subcategory. In fact, the embedding functor has a left adjoint functor so that we can think of a convolution kernel, QR. And when convoluting with QR gives you the functor of this. If you have some sheaf in E2, in E1, then convoluting with E1 times E2, it eats E1, so something left in E2. And convolution with respect to the T part, so it gives something in E times RT. And moreover, actually we have a description of subcategory of objects supported on simplified ball and outside simplified ball. And this is a quotient by this. And the quotient is given by a sheaf kernel of convolution. So we have a triangulated sequence here, triangle here, distinguished triangle. So convoluting with PR gives you the functor from these to this, from everything to object supported on simplified ball. And convoluting with K with K delta gives you the same thing. It's an identical functor. Convoluting with QR gives you shift outside the ball. Okay? So this is the story of simplicity projector, and it's a theorem that needs to be proved. So now let's consider contact structure as conic symplectic space. So say X is an odd dimensional space, R2 and plus 1. And here, we have a pre-quantization of our ball, so a contact ball in R space, and we can lift this space up. So that's because we regard the circle as RZ quotient with Z, with integer. So we can lift this to this R2 and plus 1. And then, in this R2 and plus 1, there is a, it is a quotient of the cotangent space by scale lift, by positive scale lift. And this data is the cotangent part of Z. So we can first lift this by universal cover of S1, and then lift this to a cone inside this cotangent, this simplicity manifold. Okay, so in contact case, we still have objects category supported, object supported on or outside contact ball. So it's the same thing that we can define this to be the object supported outside the cone CR. I mean the cone of our contact ball. And this also has a joint functor that we can define a subcategory called object supported on contact ball, which becomes a quotient by quotient out those shifts with mechanical singular support outside this cone. Okay? And just like this case, in simplicity space, homogeneous simplicity, actually, in contact case, we also have the kernel, but in this time it's not called a convolution kernel, it's called composition kernel, because we don't have a single extra variable, actually we have two. So, and it's easy to show that if we just pull back the simplicity kernels, projector kernel by a difference map, then it becomes a contact projective kernel that's composing with this contact projector is the same thing as convoluting with simplistic projector. So, from the whole category, the play field, to this supported on CR is given by the composition. Okay? So for this, once we get this projector, we can construct a contact invariance. But the thing here is that we are doing things over Euclidean space, not S1. So we need something to detect S1 as a quotient of R by Z, by integers. Okay, so consider this. Let T be a constant shift on supported on the shifted diagonal. So it means that this is a diagonal on E part. And it's shifted by 1 on Z part. And we want to describe this Z action. And so we pick an integer and consider this cyclic shifting action on this. And consider this is our invariant, an outcome of this and from this to this. So it's no longer a shift, it's a complex of K vector space or abelian group. So this represents the ball, the size of ball, of simplistic part of the ball. And this represents this character detects the Z equivariant structure. Okay. So by the same time, we can also lift our contact morphism as a contact morphism on R to R. And lift it again to be a homogeneous simplicial isotopy. And actually, as I said before, that consider the graph. The graph of a phi n should be a Lagrangian in x times x. But here we can do something more that once for all, we can consider all parameters in one Lagrangian. And because this is an isotopic covenant joined to the identity map, so every such homogeneous simple automorphism should be Hamiltonian. So it's dominated by some Hamiltonian function. So we just put the minus of Hamiltonian function in the cotangent part of our parameter. Then this becomes a Lagrangian, becomes a Lagrangian in this big cotangent space. Okay. In a very recent theory by Kashira Shapira and Guillemot, said that it's called shift quantization, quantizing our Hamiltonian simple automorphism. That there is a unique shift such that the microlevel singular support of this shift is exactly lambda. And so it means that composing with this shift gives you the Hamiltonian evolution in our space. And also, it has a backward evolution described by another shift. Okay. So in this case, we can show that this is actually an invariant under contact homomorphism, contact isotopy actually. And this holds not only for the ball. This holds for every open set. Open domain here. If you can find the projector with respect to this open domain, then just conjugating of this projector with this shift quantization, you get the projector of the image, the evolution. Okay, so we also have some naturality that if we assume that there is an embedding that embeds the big one into a smaller one. But here we don't know the size, just some number. And this is the embedding to the whole thing, to the whole space. And you can consider this R2n as B infinity, the law of infinity size. And the projector of this guy actually can correspond to K delta that we described before. Okay, so from this sequence, we can derive the morphism between their projector and then the diagram of induced morphism on their contact invariant, which is going another way. So, okay, this from this to this. And actually we have this to this, and these two are equal. Okay. Okay, so now here comes the Zn action. So actually the shifting action gives you a Zn action on our contact invariant. So remember this is a complex, then with an action on this. So it becomes an object in the third category of this KZN, this group algebra. Okay, so we're going to use this structure. So the thing is that if we pick n as a prime number, then it allows us to compute each one of these in a equivariant way. Okay? And also, we can compute the morphism between them. And actually, by considering some loop space of these things, we have three, and we can divide the circle into three parts. And furthermore, we can divide every part into some sub-partition. So that on each part of them, we have an explicit description of what the shift on this looks like. So it allows us to do computation by some generating function technique. But this subdivision is independent of our story. Okay. So we can compute some compact cohomology of such loop space satisfying some condition, and then the thing is that we're working over this group algebra allows us to show that when we pass into the exterior algebra, then both this guy and this guy gives us a non-zero element in this case. And then If you take n sufficiently large enough, then it can separate big R and small r such that as an element in this X algebra, degree of the big one is less than the degree of the smaller one. So, which is impossible because this must be in the X algebra, this must be a product of this and this, and they are both non-zero. So the degree of this must be bigger than the degree of this. So that leads to a contradiction. So that's the essential, the way to prove such squeezing is impossible. Yeah. Okay. So I'm done. Thank you for your attention.